Chapter 13, The Heart and Heart Disease. So the heart is a triangular-shaped organ located in the mediastinum, which, remember, mediastinum is sort of mid-chest. It's one of the cavities that we studied in Chapter 1. And that's with two-thirds of the mass is actually for the heart. Two-thirds of the heart's mass is located to the left of the body's midline, and one-third is located to the right. The apex of the heart is actually the bottom, and that's located down on the diaphragm. So you can see in this picture, down here would be the apex, which rests on the diaphragm. The diaphragm is the muscle that sort of divides this upper part of the chest cavity from your abdomen. And if you close your hand to make a fist, that's about the size and shape that your heart would be. So for some basic anatomy of the heart can be divided into four chambers. There are two upper chambers called the atria, and those are right and left based on their position. And then the two lower chambers are called the ventricles, also right and left. And when you're defining these, the right and left are according to the patient's or the person's right or left. So your right atria, or right atrium, and your right ventricle are located on your right side. And your left atrium and your left ventricle are located on your left side. There are also valves. These valves are placed between your atria and your ventricles, as well as between here your atria and your ventricles, as well as between your ventricle and the vessel that leaves your ventricles. So here you have the tricuspid valve. That is the valve located between your right atria and your right ventricle, and your pulmonary valve. And your pulmonary valve divides your right ventricle from the pulmonary vessels, which leave from it and actually take unoxygenated blood to your lungs, where they can pick up oxygen. Then over on the left side of your heart, you have your bicuspid valve. Your bicuspid valve differentiates or is the barrier or doorway between your right atria and your right ventricle. And then when your blood leaves your right ventricle, it leaves out your aorta. And so you have an aortic semilunar valve. So your two semilunar valves are the ones that are between your ventricle and the outflowing vessel, and your cuspid valves, either your tri or bicuspid, are the doorways between your atria and your ventricles. So your heart valves and then some valve disorders. So the valve's job is basically just to keep blood from flowing backwards through the heart. It prevents a backflow. So basically, if my atria squeeze and start to pump blood into my ventricles, what happens is once the pressure in that ventricles reaches a higher pressure than in the atria, it closes those valves and prevents the blood from flowing back up into my atria, which at this point would have a less resistance. So it's used to help keep blood moving in that forward direction. Your atrioventricular valves, those are your cuspid valves. And like I said before, when we looked at the picture, those are located between your atria and between your atria and your ventricles. So you have your tricuspid valve, which is on the right, and your bicuspid, also known as your mitral valve, which is located on the left. And then you have your semilunar valves. So your semilunar valves, so you remember back to that picture, are either pulmonary, which is between your right ventricle and your pulmonary artery. It's always an artery. If it leaves the heart, it's an artery. If it goes towards the heart, it's a vein. So between your right ventricle and your pulmonary artery is your pulmonary semilunar valve. And then between your left ventricle and your aorta, which is an artery, is your aortic semilunar valve. So those ones are a lot easier to remember because the name of those particular valves is just named after the vessel that happens to be leaving the heart. So for heart chambers, the wall of each heart chamber is composed of cardiac muscle tissue, which is called myocardium. And then the endocardium is the smooth lining on the inside of the heart, of those heart chambers. And inflammation of the endocardium is called endocarditis. So itis always means inflammation, and endocarditis because it's an inflammation of the endocardium, which has to do with the inside of the heart. So an inflamed endocardium can actually become very rough and very abrasive, which can start causing your blood to clot inside your heart and can start forming a thrombus. So remember, a thrombus is a stationary blood clot. An emboli is one that's actually mobile and circulating. So here you can actually just see another picture of your the wall and the lining of your heart. So this one's just a close-up. You can see your endocardium there on the inside. So you can see where this isn't a smooth surface. So if it became inflamed, it would actually allow a lot of stuff to kind of stick in those little holes and start to create a thrombus. Then here you can see a nice thick cardiac muscle. And the reason for this thick cardiac muscle is because your heart has to do so much pumping. Think about this one little muscle that's the size of your fist, including those big open chambers, has to pump blood all the way around your body. So it makes sense that it's so big and strong. So your pericardium is a two-layered fibrous sac with some lubrication in between that is around the outside of your heart. The inner layer is called your visceral pericardium. The outer layer is called your parietal pericardium. You should be able to remember the visceral and parietal terms from the first chapter that we covered when we talked about the linings and the fact that visceral covers an organ and parietal covers the cavity. So the heart action. So when the heart is contracted, that is called systole. When the heart is relaxed, that is called diastole. So contracted systole, relaxed diastole. So here you can see a picture of the heart in the two different types of contraction that it does. And this top one here is atrial contraction, because remember there are four chambers and the top and bottom ones work together, but your top ones squeeze to pump blood down into your bottom ones, and then your bottom ones, your ventricles squeeze to pump blood throughout your body. So your heart, like I said, has those two separate pumps. Your right atria and ventricle actually perform a different function than your left atria and ventricle, besides the fact that your atria tend to pump together and your ventricles pump together. And that's because your right atria and right ventricle have unoxygenated blood in them. So here, as we can see by the blue, these are unoxygenated. So when this side of your heart pumps, it's actually your right atria collects unoxygenated blood from the body and pumps it to your right ventricle so that your right ventricle can pump it, out to your lungs so that it can pick up oxygen. Then it returns to your left side of your heart. Your atria is kind of that first collection chamber, and then it drains into your left ventricle so that it can pump oxygenated blood throughout your body. And here's just another picture to help hopefully just get you to see it in a little bit different way. So here the blue is unoxygenated, so collected here in this right atria, and then pumped out by that right ventricle to your lungs, where it's going to pick up oxygen, and then be collected in your left atria to go to your left ventricle, and then be pumped out to your body so that your body can use that oxygen. So sequence of blood flow. Kind of been covering this, so in case you haven't guessed yet, this is something that I think is pretty important to know. And that's just because I find that knowing the sequence of blood flow really helps you to understand a lot of vascular disorders, because you just have that underlying base knowledge where you really just know how blood's flowing and how it's happening. So venous blood flow is going to enter your right atria. It enters your right atria through your superior and inferior vena cava. So those are the two really big vessels that are going to drain into your right atrium, your right atria. Then blood is going to flow through your tricuspid valve and into your right ventricle. From your right ventricle, it passes through your pulmonary semilunar valve and to the pulmonary artery. Because remember, anything that leaves the heart is called an artery, where it goes out to your lungs. From there, the blood picks up oxygen in your lungs and then returns to your left atrium before passing through your bicuspid or mitral valve and draining into your left ventricle. Then your left ventricle, which is the biggest and strongest of all your heart chambers, is going to pump the blood through your aorta or through your aortic semilunar valve and out through your aorta so that it can be distributed throughout the body. So your heart, if you take a listen, has two very distinct heart sounds, I'm getting ahead of myself and going to the respiratory system already, has two very distinct heart sounds, and that would be the lub-dub. So if I listen to my heart right now, it would sound like lub-dub, 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 lub-dub. The first sound, that lub noise, is caused by the vibration that you hear when your AV valves are closing. So your AV valves, those are your cuspid valves, the ones in between your atria and your ventricles. So when they close during the contraction of your ventricles, you hear that lub sound. Now the second sound that you hear, the dub sound, is caused by the closure of your semilunar valves during the relaxation of your ventricles after blood starts flowing out through and into your vascular space. A heart murmur is actually when you have an abnormal heart sound, and that is normally caused by an abnormal closing of those valves. So we will talk a little bit more about heart murmurs and abnormal valves later on, but just to cover some more basics, first, stroke volume. Stroke volume is the volume of the volume of blood that is ejected from the ventricle with each beat. So cardiac output is the amount of blood that one ventricle can pump each minute. The average cardiac output is about 5 liters per minute while the body is at rest. So the heartbeat is normally very regular and rhythmic. Each complete beat is called a cardiac cycle. On average, an adult's heart rate is between 60 and 100 beats per minute. Each cycle lasts about 0.8 seconds long and is divided into systole, so remember that is the contraction phase, and diastole, which is the relaxation phase. So blood, which supplies oxygen and nutrients to the myocardium of the heart, flows out through your right and left coronary arteries. These are a couple of arteries that actually come right off the aorta. So one of the very first things that happens when your blood leaves the heart is that it circulates or feeds itself. So a blockage of blood flow through one of these coronary arteries is actually what causes a myocardial infarction, which is more commonly known as a heart attack. So remember how I said we would be covering valve disorder soon? Well, that time has come. So the first valve disorder that we will cover is an incompetent valve. This is known as a valve that leaks. What this means is that the valve doesn't close tightly and it allows some of the blood to flow backwards into the chamber from which it came. This is also known as valve regurgitation because it's not staying where it's supposed to. It's actually being regurgitated back to its previous chamber. Another disorder is called rheumatic heart disease, and this is cardiac damage which is resulting from a delayed inflammatory response to a strep infection called rheumatic fever. So rheumatic fever is caused by a problem in your immune system. This happens to as a response to one of the strep bacteria, the same bacteria that causes strep throat. And what happens is, in this case, the immune system not only fights off the bacteria, but it becomes a little overzealous and starts attacking itself and attacking its own tissue. And often it attacks its own heart tissue, which makes the valves, as you can see here, this is kind of an enhanced image, not close and seal well, which allows some blood to flow back into the chamber from which it came. Another problem that can happen is a stenosed valve. This is when the valves are narrow and very stiff, which means that they reduce the blood flow that is allowed to flow through them. So here, you can see a nice, healthy valve. It's smooth, closes tightly, and there's nothing that's going to restrict it from opening up well. And then over here, you can see a stenotic valve. So this valve is trying to open. You can see that there's a lot of damage, and so it's not opening up completely. It's really severely limiting the amount of blood that can flow out of the previous chamber. Another problem that can happen is called mitral valve prolapse. So if you remember correctly, your mitral valve is located on the left. Now the reason why this one can be a particular problem is because your left ventricle creates a lot of pressure. It's a very strong valve, or a very strong chamber of your heart, because it has to pump blood all the way out through your body. So if there's less resistance for that blood to flow back into your atria than to flow out through your aorta, that's where it'll go, which will severely limit the amount of blood that you're going to circulate to the rest of your body. And less blood means less oxygen and less nutrients. So mitral valve prolapse is when there's an incompetence of your mitral valve, which causes the edges to extend backwards into the atria instead of sealing tightly when the valve sealing tightly when they close. So what'll happen is actually one of these will kind of flip backwards, one of these valves here, instead of sealing tightly, which allows a lot of blood flow to just go back up into that atria. So another problem is pericarditis. Pericarditis is a condition in which the sac-like covering around the heart called the pericardium becomes very inflamed. So here, this is actually a picture of a pericardial effusion. I put it up here just because it gives you a good example of the heart inside the pericardium and what can happen when something's in there. So pericardial effusion is actually when this space here fills with fluid. But if it's a pericarditis, what happens is that this sac right here, so see how much more sac there is than heart, becomes inflamed. But it also has pretty similar effect, where it's actually squeezing in on the heart. It's not going to let the heart expand and move like it normally would, because that sac that's around the heart is already distended and stiff from being inflamed. So it's not going to allow the heart to expand and then contract like it normally would, which is going to limit the amount of blood flow that you can expel out of your heart with every heartbeat. So another pretty severe problem would be cardiac tamponade. Cardiac tamponade is when there's compression of the heart because there's a fluid buildup between those visceral layers of the pericardium, or of the visceral pericardium, I mean, and the parietal pericardium. So this is kind of a type of pericardial tamponade, or pericardial effusion. There we go. And you can see here, this is just a little bit more graphic picture, where you can see that there's a fluid buildup. Most of the time it's blood, probably 9 times out of 10. And what happens is that it actually squeezes the heart because fluid keeps pouring in. Normally it's by a ruptured vessel that just allows blood to keep pouring in. And the more blood that fills up this space, the less room your heart has to move. So this can actually be a life-threatening event. So moving away a little bit from the heart itself and out towards the vessels, we can have a lot of coronary or circulation problems. One of them is atherosclerosis, and this is a type of hardening of the arteries in which lipids build up on the inside of the vessel walls and actually cause a total or even conventionally become a complete blockage in coronary blood flow. So here you can see a normal artery, and here you can see one where there is a lipid blockage right here. See how it's that huge big plaque there? But what that's actually doing is really making that part of the wall very stiff. It's not going to be able to expand and contract and dilate like it normally would. And it's also limiting a lot of the blood flow that can fit through, because now this space, you can see here, it's been taken away by more than half. So not only is it stiff, but it's a severe reduction in how much blood can fit through there at a time anyway. So what this does is that it really limits the amount of blood flow, which means you're kind of starting to starve the tissues on the other side. You're not providing them with a normal amount of oxygen, the normal amount of nutrients, which means that maybe they're okay under normal conditions, but maybe if you start to demand a little bit more of them or work a little bit harder, they start to starve and they don't get enough oxygen to function correctly because you simply can't physically provide them with enough blood flow. So now that we've taken a quick break away from the heart, I know that there are, seems like a million things that can go wrong with your heart. Let's go back to the heart and look at what something like that can actually cause. So if you have atherosclerosis, that can actually lead to either angina or a myocardial infarction or a heart attack. So if I have a limited amount of blood flow to my heart, like I said, because if I have atherosclerosis, what can happen is I can start developing angina pectoralis. And what angina pectoralis is that it's chest pain that is caused by an inadequate flow of oxygen to my heart muscle. So if I have atherosclerosis and now I have a limited amount of blood that can get to part of my heart muscle, and I start running. So I know I'm overweight, I know I'm out of shape, I'm going to start running to get in shape. So I start running, but every time I run, I start getting chest pain, and I'm afraid I'm having a heart attack. But whenever I stop, it goes away. That's called angina, because it's not actually damaging the tissue completely, because it's not a complete blockage of flow. It's just that when I'm increasing the demand on my heart, I start to feel pain because my heart muscle can't keep up with that increased demand. So angina doesn't last long term. Normally, once I stop the extra demand on my heart, it goes away. But it's normally caused by that partial blockage. So it's an inadequate oxygen to the heart muscle, even though it is getting oxygen. It's just inadequate to meet the excess demands that I'm putting on it. Where a myocardial infarction is actually when there's death of heart muscle, because there's a sudden, acute, and complete blockage of the coronary artery. Oftentimes, this is caused by a blood clot. So if I have something like atherosclerosis that's making my blood vessels stiff and narrow, and it actually can make them a little bit sticky. So now let's say that I have a little blood clot floating around and it kind of gets lodged in that narrow space, and it's also a little bit sticky. So now it's stuck there, and maybe some stuff gets backed up behind it because it's sticky, and now it just forms a bigger clot and a bigger clot. But now what happens is that everything distal to it, like you can see here in this picture, this is a picture of this blood clot right here, which is blocking off the blood flow of these vessels, which means this part of the heart is no longer getting the oxygen and other nutrients that it needs to survive. And very quickly that heart muscle starts to die. And that's causing a heart attack. So, getting away from some of the problems that can happen, let's go back to some of the normal things with a heart. So, the heart has a very specific conduction system. First, there's the SA node, or the sinoatrial node, and this is known as the pacemaker of the heart. And this is located on the wall of the right atrium near the opening of the superior vena cava. And what this does is it actually triggers your atria to contract. So the electrical impulse travels from the SA node down your atria, triggering them to contract. And then it hits your AV node. And now, just like your AV valves are located between your atria and your ventricles, your AV node is located between your atria and your ventricles. And this is located in the right atrium along the very lower part near the internal septum. This internal septum is the divider between your right and left ventricle. And that is going to be what starts to send the message to contract down your ventricles. And then finally, it's going to hit your AV bundle, also known as the bundle of His. And this is located in the septum. And will help continue to project the impulse across the ventricles. And then finally, it's going to reach the Purkinje fibers, which are located on the outer walls of the ventricles. Now, something that's important to know is that your SA node is your pacemaker of your heart. So that's going to conduct at the normal rate, so normally at 60 to 100 beats per minute. But let's say my SA node doesn't fire. Well, my AV node kind of works like a backup pacer. And that, if I don't have an SA node, I don't have an electrical impulse to trigger it and tell it when to fire, is going to eventually kick in itself. But it works a little bit slower. It's going to work at a rate more like 40 to 60 beats a minute. So it's sort of like the backup pacemaker. And then your other ones, your AV bundle, your bundle of His, and your Purkinje fibers, those are also kind of even more backup pacers, but they're barely adequate for survival. They're only going to tell your heart to contract at a rate of 20 to 40 beats a minute, which is significantly lower than the 60 to 100 that your SA would tell your heart to contract at if all was functioning normally. So here's just a picture so that you can see where your SA node is up here. And then this is going to send these impulses to contract to your other atria and down to your AV node, which is then going to send it down your bundle of His and out to your Purkinje fibers to tell your ventricles to contract. So, electrocardiography. So this is also known as an ECG or an EKG. So this is a transthoracic interpretation of the electrical activity of the heart. Normally it's over a period of time. We do this by placing electrodes that are attached to the skin that actually pick up on that electrical impulse that is sent down through your heart. And this creates a visible tracing that we can see and then interpret to tell how well those electrical impulses are traveling and if there are any problems in your heart conduction. So, this talks a lot about polarization and repolarization. I don't really expect you to know that. What I expect you to know are just some very simple basics here. So your P wave. Your P wave is the first wave that you'll see. It's just a little bump. And what that little bump is it's your atria. That is your AV node telling your atria to contract. So after that, what happens is this great big one, and this is QRS, and that is the message going down your ventricles. So that is your ventricles contracting. It's your QRS. And then finally, there's your little T wave, which is sort of telling everything to go back to normal. So I do expect you guys to know this. I expect you to be able to draw out one of these and know what it's called, like all these things. So P, Q, R, S, T. Sorry, I'm drawing it there in the air, so you can't really see it very well. So P, Q, R, S, and T, and what each one is. So pretty much all what I would expect there is this P wave is your atria, the Q, R, S is your ventricles. So that's when they're contracting. But because of that, what it does is that it's going to allow us to be able to look at an EKG and actually interpret what's going on with your heart. So if you have a problem with your ventricles or if you have a problem with your atria, we can look at this and actually be able to have an idea what that problem is without actually visually seeing your heart itself. So, just to look at some cardiac dysarrhythmias, these I believe are the exact ones that are in your book. So this is called normal sinus rhythm. Normal sinus rhythm is how heart conduction normally happens in a normal heart beating pattern. So here you can see it's a nice regular rhythm. If you counted this out, the rate would be in the 60 to 100 range because that's what it has to be normal sinus. You can see a normal P, normal QRS, everything looks the same and nice and rhythmic. So normal sinus rhythm. But we can have a lot of alterations. So bradycardia, and yes, I do expect you guys to know these, bradycardia means a slow heart rate. Tachycardia means a fast heart rate. In general, anytime you see brady, it means slow. Anytime you see tachy, it means fast. A sinus dysarrhythmia means everything looks normal, but it's not happening in a normal, regular rhythm. So as you can see here, sometimes they're closer, sometimes they're further away. But each beat itself, if you just looked at it individually, would look normal. This is called a PVC or a premature ventricular contraction. It's kind of this really weird, huge beat. And what that means is it's just your ventricles contracted without getting the impulse from your atria first. Over here, we can see atrial fibrillation. So fibrillation basically just means a like crazy vibration. So instead of your heart beating on a nice regular rhythm for your atria is actually just like shaking or quivering. It's not beating regularly, which means it's not effectively squeezing that blood from your upper chamber to your lower chamber. And what that causes is it makes it so that if you look here, you don't see that nice smooth line and that one defined P wave. I was trying to find a good one up here. That would be a nice defined P wave right there. You don't see that. You just sort of see like almost a little kind of jagged wavy line. And that's because there's not just one P wave. There are a whole bunch of them and they're happening super fast. So that makes it so you don't see a defined P wave. Another thing with atrial fibrillation, also known as AFib often, is that it means your heart rate becomes irregular. And AFib is kind of an interesting thing in itself because it means that because your atria are just quivering and they're not pumping, blood can actually start to accumulate in your atria because it's not pumping it out. It becomes stagnant, doesn't flow very well through there because they're just quivering, they're not pumping, so blood's not flowing well. And what does stagnant blood do? It clots. So AFib actually puts you at a very high risk for developing blood clots. As well as the fact that this rhythm's irregular and it can become very, very fast because your atria is quivering. So sometimes if that impulse actually starts traveling down into your ventricles, it can make your ventricles start beating even faster, which means that they're not pumping very effectively because now they're not only not getting the impulses from, or the fill from your atria, now the impulses that it's getting are fast and irregular, which means it's really not filling. And then we over here have ventricular fibrillation, which is when your ventricles are doing the same thing that your atria are in AFib. So your ventricles are just sort of quivering or shaking instead of beating normally. And what that means is that now your ventricles actually aren't pumping out blood to your body. They're just sort of quivering. And VFib, or ventricular fibrillation, is actually known as one of the deadly arrhythmias. It's one of those things where if we don't fix it, if we don't give you CPR or shock your heart to try to reset its heart rhythm, it'll actually kill you. Then finally, we'll go up here to the heart, or to the number A, or letter A, I guess. Complete heart block. Complete heart block. This is when your atria are firing at their own little set intervals, but it's not in conjunction with your QRS anymore or your ventricles anymore. So if I measured these out, my ventricles would be at a set rhythm and my atria would be at a set rhythm. They're just not talking to each other anymore. So now I'm going to explain all those a little bit more. Again, I know you're all probably sick of me by now. Can tell I probably like the heart. So heart block. So that was A there. Heart block is when the conduction impulse is totally blocked. So your atria might be contracting, and the impulse might be normal through your atria, but it's not being carried down to your ventricles. So your ventricles aren't contracting normally like they should be. And this is called complete heart block because there is an impairment of AV node production or conduction, sorry. And what that does is that it produces a complete disassociation of your P wave from your QRS. So that's kind of like what I said. Your P wave might be normal and your QRS might be normal, but they're kind of each happening without talking to each other. They're happening at their own set rhythm. But the problem with that is that if you remember correctly, what I said is that if your AV node, or if your SA node isn't communicating with your AV node and telling it to fire, is that your AV node kind of has its own backup pacer, but it's a lot slower. It's going to fire at 40 to 60 beats a minute, which means that oftentimes these people have very, very slow heart rates and oftentimes end up needing an implanted artificial pacemaker to tell their heart to keep beating so that it goes at a faster and more normal rate to make sure that they're actually circulating enough blood for their survival. And then this is just a description of the rest of those arrhythmias that I told you about. So like I said, bradycardia is a slow heart rate. Anything less than 60, because remember normal was 60 to 100, is considered bradycardia or slow. Tachycardia is a rapid heart rate. Anything more than 100 beats a minute is considered tachycardia. Sinus dysarrhythmia is when there's a variation in heart rate during the normal cycle. And normally it oftentimes follows breathing, like speeds up and slows down according to the breathing. But it just means that everything looks normal if you look at them individually, but it doesn't follow a normal regular pattern. And then a premature contraction. So that's when the contraction of your ventricles actually occurs sooner than expected in the normal rhythm. You can actually have PACs or premature atrial contractions as well, but PVCs or premature ventricular contractions are far more common. And then there's fibrillation, which is a condition in which the cardiac muscle actually just vibrate or quiver instead of actually pumping, which means that they don't produce any effective pumping action, which causes them to really not be circulating oxygenated blood out to your body. And especially if it's ventricular fibrillation, if that's what you have, your ventricles are the ones that are quivering or vibrating and not pumping, it'll actually eventually kill you if not corrected. So finally, let's cover heart failure. Heart failure is a different thing than one of those heart rhythms we were just talking about. And that is the inability of the blood to, our inability to pump enough returned blood out to sustain life. So you can't pump enough blood to keep you healthy and alive. So you can have systolic heart failure, which means that your heart muscle literally cannot pump or eject enough blood out of your heart. Or you can have diastolic heart failure, which means that your heart muscles are very stiff and so they don't really fill up with blood very well, which means that even if they pump out every single drop that's in them, it's not enough blood because they just can't fill with enough blood in the first place. Now, besides just systolic and diastolic heart failure, you can also have right-sided heart failure and left-sided heart failure. Right-sided heart failure is actually the failure of the right side of the heart to pump blood. And often that's actually a side effect of having left-sided heart failure or some sort of lung disease. Because you remember, the right side of your heart pumps that blood forward into your lungs so that it can pick up oxygen. So if you have an issue with the left side of your heart, it might actually be causing a backup of fluid into your lungs and then into the right side of your heart. Or if you have some sort of lung disease, it might actually limit the amount of blood that can flow forward into your lungs. And then a left-sided heart failure, this is also known as congestive heart failure, is the inability of the left ventricle to pump blood forward effectively. This often results in congestion of the systemic and pulmonary circulations, because what happens if the left side can't pump forward that blood? So it's going to back up into your lungs and then back up into your right side of your heart and then finally back up into your systemic system. Now, a sign I actually forgot to mention here for the right side is that if you have right-sided heart failure, normally what happens is you become very edematous and very swollen, and a lot of that fluid, because it can't go into the right side of your heart, actually starts backing up into the rest of your body. So what are some causes of this? This can be caused by coronary artery disease. Coronary artery disease are things like atherosclerosis, those very stiff or partially blocked vessels. If you have a myocardial infarction, because now you have some dead cardiac tissue, and that dead cardiac tissue just isn't going to pump as effectively. If you have a valve disorder, so let's say I have mitral valve prolapse. Well, now I'm not pumping that blood forward very well, so now I have a backup of blood into my left side of my heart, which is going to eventually back up into my lungs. If I have a dysarrhythmia, if I'm suffering from VFib or ventricular fibrillation, obviously I'm not pumping my blood forward very effectively. Or if I have some sort of congenital heart disease, something I was born with that's making my heart not pump as it really correctly should. So a cardiomyopathy. Cardiomyopathy is a disease which weakens and enlarges your heart muscle. And this makes it harder for your heart to pump and to deliver blood out to the rest of your body. There are many causes for cardiomyopathy, and these include coronary artery disease, or some sort of valvular disease. And that's because it's some sort of blockage that is making your heart have to work harder over a period of time to pump that blood forward. So eventually what might happen is that maybe your heart gets altered in its form from having to work so hard to pump blood forward that it actually sort of damages itself in the process. And the problem with cardiomyopathy is that it can actually lead to heart failure and some long-term permanent changes in how well the body can deliver, or how well the heart can deliver that oxygenated blood to the rest of your body. So here are just the pictures of cardiomyopathy. So you can have dilated cardiomyopathy. Here is just where the heart, all of the heart chambers are dilated and bigger than normal. You can have hypertonic cardiomyopathy, which is when the walls of your cardiac muscle have just gotten very big. So look at how much bigger that myocardium is compared to this one. But what it had to do is that it actually grew inward, so it had to shrink the chambers in order to grow that muscle. And that muscle gets big like that if it has to pump out against a lot of resistance. Or here there's restrictive cardiomyopathy, which is just when the walls become very, very stiff. They're not necessarily any thicker, but they're very stiff, so they're not going to expand or contract like normal. And finally, last slide, I'm just going to briefly touch on CPR. So CPR is cardiopulmonary resuscitation, and this is the rhythmic compression of the heart between your sternum and your vertebrae. So actually, our anatomy is what allows us to do CPR and potentially save somebody's life. So what CPR does is, because we're rhythmically compressing somebody's heart between their sternum and their vertebrae, we're sort of simulating a normal heart contraction by squeezing blood forward out of their heart and through their heart chambers before it goes out of their heart, to try to maintain blood flow through a cardiac arrest if their heart has actually already stopped. And this, if combined with artificial respiration, can actually save somebody's life if we can then correct whatever the problem was in the first place. I've actually seen it work on numerous people, taking care of a lot of people in the hospital who had a sort of cardiac arrest and their heart stopped and survived CPR, and they corrected the problem and actually lived meaningful lives after. So CPR is definitely very important and can be very life-saving. All right, so this is going to complete chapter 13, and I will see you guys all again for chapter 14.